This is why we should have Christmas every Sunday. Every Sunday. Let us pray. Our understanding of your word comes from you, God. Open our ears and our minds and our hearts to hear what you would have to say to us. Help us upon hearing to understand, and upon understanding to act. In Jesus' name, amen. I have always wanted to say Merry Christmas in July. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
I'm not sure why I've always wanted to do that. Maybe it's because it's amusing and it's just kind of different and it has a way of tickling my fancy. But I hope that's the same for you as well. You'll see in the room, we've got all four Advent banners. We've got all of the Advent candles lit, and we have a tree lit, but we don't have decorations on it. And so between now and next Sunday, if you would like to go dig way up in the attic or way down in the basement, wherever it is, to find an ornament to bring and add to that. We'll do that next week. So we're going to add to this as we go along. Plus, you know, every so often it doesn't hurt to mix things up a bit. So we're not in the sanctuary, we're in the fellowship hall this morning. And we started this last summer when we were updating the sanctuary, and folks, we said we really like kind of being able to see each other and to hear each other and see who falls asleep. So here we are. According to my extensive Google research, the phrase Christmas in July dates back to 1940, and there was a comedy film that was released that year called Christmas in July, and the plot centered on this life-changing windfall of good fortune, literally, that fell in the lap of an office worker named Jimmy McDonald. Thing is, the whole thing was fabricated by his colleagues, previous colleagues, but he didn't know that. And no one else did. And in the end, after several twists and turns and such, Jimmy gets a big promotion. He gets to keep all of that money. And of course, he gets the girl of his dreams. This is a phrase that has been with us for a while. Some retailers hold Christmas in July sales to clear out old inventories before they usher in the new. Hallmark Channel has a Christmas keepsake week around this time of year. I don't know if you've seen it or not. It's actually grown to more than a week. And what they do is run lots of Christmas movies, and then they debut new ones. And there are 38 new Christmas movies this year, just this year. I'm not sure who would want to go up against It's a Wonderful Life and White Christmas. I mean, those are the classics. But I also read somewhere that the Hallmark folks take this opportunity to lift up the new keepsake ornament in that series. Lots of folks live for those. So in the bottom line, in the world of retail, there's a dollar to be made off of Christmas in July, one way or another. But here this morning, and for the next two Sundays, we're celebrating Christmas in the middle of the calendar year, all for a different reason. It's a way to explore what the wondrous gift of the Christ child means apart from all that maddening rush in December that normally nestles it. This time of year, there are no holiday parties. There's no endless Muzak or Jose Feliciano singing Feliz Navidad. Your new earworm. No Santa Claus and his reindeer, no shopping lists, no eggnog, no late night assemblies of toys and other things on Christmas Eve. There's none of that this time of year. So what's left? What is there instead? Let's begin with a story. Second chapter of Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for him in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may never have heard the name of Hoyt Axton. Does anyone know who Hoyt Axton is? Yeah, Walt, okay. His major claim to fame is that he wrote the lyrics to the song "Joy to the World." Not the one we sang in the hymnal earlier. He's the one with the first line, "Jeremiah was a bullfrog." He wrote the song for an animated TV special called "The Happy Song," and the TV special never aired. But Hoyt Axton pitched that song to the band Three Dog Night, and the rest is history. "Joy to the World" made it to the top of the Billboard for 6 weeks in a row in 1971, my freshman year in high school. And here's a bit of trivia you're going to be able to use at some point.